Congealed remnants of hydraulic engineering, colonial extraction, and petrocapitalist circulation, artificial earths, brackish waters, and blockades. This used to be an island until 1865, when the construction of the North Sea Canal linked to the emerging financial nexus of Amsterdam's trading flows with the colonial cargo brought ashore by oceanic trade routes. Ruigoord is surrounded by the brackish water of the Iron Bay. The labor-intensive excavation of a shipping channel from the eastern shores of the Eye to the newly built sea lock at Lightwood also moved in lockstep with the drainage of surrounding waters, a vast project of geo and hydroengineering that would not only provide material ground for the industrial expansion of Amsterdam's trading capacity, but also utterly reshape the direction and density of salt water along the Eye. Transforming the hydrology of this estuary beyond recognition, the completion of the North Sea Canal in 1876 also began a continuous process of port expansion in anticipation of mounting demand, a projection of growth once fueled by the slave trade and the import of cocoa and now by petroleum and just-in-time logistics. The names of the docks that surround us, that you've seen today, scarcely conceal their position in this colonial world economy. Africa Harbor, Cacao Harbor, Texas Harbor. In the late 1960s, the village of Ruigoord was consigned to eviction as part of a planned extension of the Africa Harbour to facilitate expanded throughput in the form of coal, petroleum, and natural gas. As Jeff has told us, the existence of the ground that we gathered on this evening is an ongoing refusal of capital's capacity to subsume and refashion every social and ecological externality it encounters toward the logic of accumulation. The squatting of this particular building in 1973 and the subsequent events of Ruigoord was an instance of friction in the circuitries of maritime capital, and at the same time, its existence was made possible in part by the internal contradictions of fossil fuel accumulation. As the oil crisis rippled across electrical markets in 73, demand for storage fell, and the terminal's expansion stalled momentarily, offering a minor aperture in the otherwise relentless growth of the fossil economy. And this is where we stand, at the confluence of estuarine hydrology, fossil energy, and racial capital, a point of ingress and egress, transition and impasse, at which the completing flows of brackish ecologies and logistical mobilities come to thicken and corrode the hurricanes of this littoral space. And it was this specific confluence, this encounter between estuarine and infrastructural fields, that first brought us here. When I began working with Jeff, we wanted to know how salinity and logisticality were interpolated through one another, and how this material interpolation of this milieu might place demands on the field and practice in the field. At the same time, we were fascinated by the growing prevalence of fieldwork across modes of artistic practice and research with no formal or disciplinary orientation towards a field, and how an undisciplined form of field practice might materialize in response to the specific brackish ecologies and port infrastructures at this site, and how the ecological effects of the port expansion stages an extended encounter between the critique of logistical capitalism and the critical promise of situated methods. In June last year, the FieldArts residency gathered 24 artists, researchers and writers, many of whom I'm happy to say are here tonight, for a program of intensive field study that took us from the fragile dune systems and the brackish inlets of Tessel Island, overall hosted by the Linnaeus Institute for Sea Research, and here to the Port of Amsterdam, an expansive infrastructure of colonial dispossession which now occupies contemporary attention as the site of the world's largest gasoline terminal and the longest sea lock on Earth. Unfortunately, in the course of a week, the program combined extended forays into these field sites with Marxist theorists, black feminist biologists, and benthic ecologists. Together, we sank our hands into seaweed rats on Pessel Island, attuned our methods of recording and noticing to the ecologies of its brackish inland waters. We worked with marine chemists in the laboratories of Neos, held impromptu dockside interviews with seafarers bound for the Atlantic Passage, and cast hydrophones overboard to record the sound of shifting sailor entities across the sea. Over the last month, many of us have returned to these sites, to the salt marsh at Nardamir, to the gene systems just north of here at Castricum, and finally this last week, to the sea lock at Ireland and the port itself. At the same time, our collaborators in the University of Amsterdam's Climate and Fossil Fuels project, some of whom I believe are here tonight, have worked to trace the flows of finance, capital, and fossil energy through the port, culminating in the circulation of a white paper on energy impacts and the imminent contradictions of the port's transition strategy. And so I want to introduce this evening's program of screenings, sound performances, and talks by briefly outlining three lines of inquiry that have emerged from the last year of concentrated and collective study: Salinity, Logisticality, and Field Theory. So to grasp the centrality of salt, both to the orientation of our collective thinking and to the circulation of commodities through the port, where we are situated now, I think I should offer a short gloss on brackishness. What is it? In this field doc, composed collaboratively during last year's excursion and published earlier this month by Sonic Acts Press, the first entry that you'll find is brackish. This is not so much a critical glossary as a kind of gathering of critical materials that elude or exceed the efforts of a ship's manifest to index what flows through the port. Instead, this book takes up the maritime connotations of the docket only to offer a seditious or excessive bill of lading. According to this docket, brackish comes laden with a multiplicity of meanings. Brackish, meaning the combination of seawater and freshwater found in estuaries, or produced as an effect of engineering. Naming, too, the many forms of microbial and marine life dependent on these changing saline gradients. From brak, in Middle Dutch, meaning worthless, in the idiom of maritime trade, taken originally from the early German break, to break, or that which impedes motion. Suspended between these logistical and linguistic fields, ecological and economic, brackishness is simultaneously an impediment, a waste product, a transitional body of water. Occurring at the estuary mouth where the salt tongue meets the freshwater outflow of the river, brackish water is not exactly the mixing of different salinity levels, but instead the constant circulation of salt and sweet water. Manifest as subsurface turbulence, brackishness then names a state of constant and continuous transition. Generating countless ecoclimates, this state of flux produces some of the planet's most diverse marine ecosystems. And yet, if brackishness is always in transition, it appears in the circulatory systems of maritime shipping as an intransigent material, registered in the calculus of capital as an impediment to profit. And from the perspective of hydraulic engineering, brackish water is an existential threat. Since the excavation of the North Sea Canal, the drainage of the polders, and the subsequent desalination of the ice ordinary, the eye has never functioned like an estuary. Instead of freshwater flowing outward to the ocean, the incursion of salinity has threatened to contaminate agricultural groundwater and taint the supply of drinking water to the city. Keeping pace with the impact and expanded throughput of the port, this hydro engineering project has necessitated the successive construction of ever growing locks and barriers to hold back this salt, culminating in the completion last year of the world's longest sea lock, Jaisal's Imanen, and Aru Fun. A benthic ecologist, who some of you might remember from last year, met us on the dunes, just a few miles west of here, and explained to us the terminal effects of this defensive hydraulic architecture on marine life in the brackish zone. As well as stratifying saline gradients, every time the block is open to the sea, the sudden shock of saltwater proves devastating for freshwater environments upstream. As the scale of the block has expanded over time, both facilitating and anticipating the storage capacity of ever larger oil tankers, the ecological cost of circulation has increased exponentially. With each opening of the newly formed and less than 10 million kilos of saltwater accompanying cargo passed through. This week, on Wednesday, I returned to the sea for the first time in a year in a company of 20 students working with Jeff on the concept of field philosophy. We talked about the ways in which this logistical site resists attention or refuses critical apprehension. Even as you pass through the sea lock from the open water, as we did last year, it remains remarkably quiet and impressive. Its scales almost completely illegible. And it's only when we listen back to hydrophone recordings taken from the vessel, casting devices overboard before, during, and after crossing, only then did the sheer volume of this infrastructure become sensible. We've heard some of these recorded lately by Lance Laoyan during lunch. And I'm going to play something now in childhood, just a short clip, but I hope it's enough. So listening underwater, you hear the thrum of the ship's motor, the weight of single doors, the far-off sound of 90,000 meters of brackish water being pumped back into the North Sea each second. If you listen carefully, you hear the change in resonance, affected by the shifting salinity and density of water on either side of the log. It's a kind of volumetric cut instead of a transition, an audible imprint of the logistical infrastructure. So might attuning our methods to this brackish field require the submergence by human, or the adoption of what Melody June calls thinking through seawater, a form of elemental or milieu-specific analysis? In the extractive zone, Macarena Gomez-Barros articulates this question in a different way. How, she asks, might we confuse the normative boundaries of academic study by wading into what lies below the surface of late capitalism? To plunge into these waters, Gomez-Barros writes, is to insist that to research hydrological infrastructures means reckoning with what she describes as the thick capacity of a submergent world where capital attempts continually to operationalize. In our encounters with the estuary during the residency in the last year, this cross-hatching of colonial, ecotonal, and logistical space compels us similarly to think beyond or beneath any ethnographic concept of the field as a clearly bounded site of study or a transparent resource from which knowledge is extracted. Where Gomez-Barros outlines this submerged perspective as a counter-extractive method, the brackish water of the eye makes for us a comparable material and methodological reorientation towards this hydrological perspective from below. So to attend to what takes place below the surface is to realize that this ecotone has come to bear the material cost of spatial abstractions attendant on a system of calculation, circulation, and accumulation that would become known in the wake of its emergence in the 1960s as the logistics revolution. As Deborah Cowan, among many others, has explored, the origins of this global logistical system are tied historically to the invention of a now ubiquitous container, first contracted for military use by the US company Seanet during the Vietnam War. And if the historical imprint of logistics is stamped on the ecology of the estuary, the material topology of coastal space is equally inscribed on this corporate toponymy, this logistical innovation. Developing an intermodal system that would enable the movement and transfer of standardized containers between transoceanic and inland supply chains, containerization ushered in an era of transnational shipping based on the replicability of this militarized transport system across diverse locations and demands. I'm paraphrasing here, but based with falling rates of profit and production, circulation emerges as a new terrain for the extraction of surplus value. And critical histories of logistics usually begin here. They begin here with the container. And in his seminal film, The Forgotten Space, which I'm standing in front of, Alan Sekula narrates the Port of Amsterdam's centrality to global shipping in this way. And in Alberto Toscano's reading of Sekula, the attempt to figure or represent containerization becomes an attempt to map an emergent totality, to demystify the concrete abstractions encapsulated by this traceable, exchangeable, and automatable architecture. At the Port of Amsterdam, however, I think the planetary totality of logistics capital is figured differently, inflected instead by specific circulations of salt and and oil. Where Rotterdam remains central to the import of commodities to Europe, Amsterdam specializes instead in the transshipment and storage of liquid and dry bulk, such as crude oil, construction materials, and coal, as well as the bunkering and blending of petroleum commodities. In place of a container, we find silos of coal, tankers of oil, and terminals of liquefied gas. Like the estuary, the port is a complex system for holding, mixing, circulating sediment and liquid, yet it is a system bound to logistical accumulation and fossil fuel consumption, subordinated to reproduction of social and ecological life through the abstractions of commodity exchange. As the lock impedes the circulation of salinity, terminals along the port mix crude oil and gas into petroleum commodities as value-added services in the movement of fossil energy. And yet increasingly, the port envisions itself as a central site of energy transition. And the impact presented by infrastructural and financial lock-in at this site is all too clear. As you pass the Afrigarden, for which this is the picture, the offshore tour that's been commissioned by the Port Authority, the guide invites you to admire this oil terminal, an oil terminal run solely on renewable energy. And the white paper that's been drafted by our colleagues in the Climate and Fossil Fuels Research Team sets out to map this increasingly evident impasse to energy transition. Namely, the fact that the port's strategy for decarbonisation depends on a complete abstraction at the level of policy of its material function. While the phase-out of coal is slowly on the way, the current target of a carbon-neutral port by 2050 disregards entirely the continued and projected throughput of oil and natural gas. In its calculation of carbon impact, the Port of Amsterdam claims no responsibility for what is stored or circulated through its terminals. More than ambiguity in the mechanisms of legal responsibility, I think this detransition planning of the port is symptomatic of a desire to fully dematerialize financial flows. If the gaze of maritime logistics envisages the smooth movement of commodities across sea and land, figured here by the shipping platform marine traffic as a two-dimensional plane of frictionless circulation, then attending to material throughput, the waste outputs and the labor politics of the port reveals the process of abstraction on which this vision of logisticality depends. In a bulletin circulated in 2017 by the labor organizing platform Transnational Social Strike, this dynamic of selective visibility is identified as a central aspect of logistics. The imaginary of efficiency, smoothness, and technological necessity connected to the so-called logistics revolution is only part of the story, in a way. To struggle in and against this world implies the task of unveiling the conditions made behind this supposedly technical logistical transformation, bringing to light what logistics systematically makes invisible. Both in her political and academic work, our keynote speaker Charmaine Chua has played a central role in foregrounding the forms of turbulence and logistical violence brought by the system of circulation and its hidden structures of colonial expropriation that characterize labor, slow violence. As Charmaine's work demonstrates with such clarity, maritime logistics hinges on the elimination of all social and ecological impediments to circulation, encountering silting deltas, dockyard strikes, and infrastructural breakdowns as just so many instances of supply chain friction. From the perspective of capital, these blockages are often seen as opportunities for optimization. Viewed from below, these imminent contradictions are often remnants of vulnerability or leverage. Returning to the encounter between saltwater and logistics systems in which we first departed, we find these dynamics of abstraction, circulation, and friction written here in media res. Though the lock has technically been functional since its completion over a year ago, the volume of saltwater released into the eye of each tanker means that it functions well below capacity. It's barely operational. Since opening the lock to allow passage into the port is an impossible burden on its hydraulic pumping system, the circulation of capital is now dependent on the development of a process called selective abstraction. While engineers develop mechanisms for the selective abstraction of saltwater inside the locks, the same immensity of this artificial estuary continues to refuse the abstract vision of littoral space as a frictionless plane of mobility. And while the unfettered circulation of capital sand, nightingale, and polystantin outline this diversity of practice-based and situated methods that fall under the bracket of fieldwork. In their terms, fieldworking is, quote, a process, a verb, grounded in and shaped by the site or situation that the artist or researcher works. From its inception over a year ago, fieldarts has been grounded by the question of how the critique of logistical capital might be situated or reoriented by immersion and transition in terminal geographies. At the same time, I think the promise of field theory also demands that we approach the field always as a site of labour, a terrain of struggle. And to practice theory in the field is not only to reckon with the reciprocal pressure of these intransigent grounds and brackish waters, but also to intervene in them, to develop practices grounded by the tactics commensurate with the distributed violence of fossil energy extraction, labour exploitation, and ecological devastation that materializes here at the port. Grounding our research here means not only recognizing, representing, or exposing the contradictions of logistical systems, but antagonizing and organizing around them. When we were returning from our field trip to the Sea Lock earlier this week, Charmaine posed a question about the metaphorization of logisticality, about the tendency of the humanities to turn to the figurative or representational in order to navigate encounters with the political economy and ecology of shipping. And as I was finishing this talk yesterday, I was just struck by the extent to which elemental metaphor has always been embedded in historical materialist accounts of transition, insurrection, counter-revolution, by the ways in which salt and sediment have written themselves into the language of the strike, into our figurations of past and future struggles. Speaking in 1856 to a gathering of Chartist revolutionaries in London, Karl Marx described the rise of industrial capitalism by recourse to a striking geologic metaphor, in which the technological revolutions and social revolts of that century appeared as cracks and fissures in the dry crust of a bourgeois epoch that, as Marx puts it, betrayed oceans of liquid matter beneath the surface. And by the turn of the 20th century, Rosa Luxemburg's seminal work of revolutionary strategy, The Mass Strike, appears fully immersed in this subsurface milieu. Here, what Luxemburg describes as the elemental power of the mass strike ripping across Russian dockyards in 1905, appears as a turbulent hydrological force, first estuarine and oceanic. It flows now like a broad billow, and now divides into a gigantic network of narrow streams. Now it bubbles forth from under the ground like a fresh spring, and now it's completely lost under the earth. Political and economic strikes, mass strikes and partial strikes, demonstrative strikes and fighting strikes, all these run through one another, run side by side, cross one another, flow through and over one another. It is a ceaselessly moving, changing sea of phenomena. In her account of the open insurrection that spread in 1905 from the oil refineries in Baku to the dockyards of Odessa, the eventual decline and retreat of this action, in which the strategic vulnerability of oil extraction and commodity circulation were tested, would nonetheless lay the groundwork for struggles to come. After every foaming wave of political action, she writes, a fructifying deposit remains behind, from which a thousand stalks of economic struggle shoot forth. Envisaging the ebb and flow of collective revolt here as the suspension and sedimentation of the precipitate of a particular matter, I want to suggest that Luxemburg's striking phrase, this fructifying deposit, might be a way of thinking through the political horizons of maritime friction, of recognizing the histories of the resistant ground on which we stand. Luxembourg's mass strike offers us an estuarine idiom through which to grasp a shipyard or oil terminal as both a field of hydrological flows and a terrain of struggle. At the same time, this early vision of the supply chain strike stretching across emergent infrastructures of production and circulation remains instructive for contemporary organizing across the multi-local and transnational scales stitched together by logistics. In the words of transnational social strike, the precarity and complexity of supply chain capitalism also presents itself, quote, as a tool of political communication, a field of organization, a chance of mass insubordination. The horizon of the mass strike, I argue, will stitch together dock worker unions, displaced populations, and popular blockades much like the university.